Testing, testing, Dr. Santa, can you hear me? Dr. Santa, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
All right, cool. Let's get cracking then. So welcome to our special presentation, Gods, African Gods and Goddesses. My name's Tony, and I'll be introduced to Dr. Asanta in a short while. For those who are new to Zoom, that's where we gave you the 5-minute kind of breakout period in that. A lot of people are not used to using Zoom, so it's just to give them the chance to actually come into the webinar space and kind of get comfortable. If it's your first time using Zoom, there's a screen that looks a bit like this, and there's something called the chat button, which is this button over here, and that's where you go to ask questions. We're taking questions after presentation, but if you have a question during the presentation, you can actually tap it in there, and you should get an answer fairly quickly. So if you have your mics on, just mute them. And if you have a question, you put it in the chat section, but we're taking questions after the actual presentation. So today's presentation, you can see what it's titled there, African Gods and Goddesses. It's the second time we've done this. The first time it was so popular, it kind of sold out. So we thought we'd do another one, which is this one here. And this one is also full last time I checked. That's a bit about what we'll be covering today, but you're gonna hear it verbally anyway, so I'll skip that for now. This is something that may be of interest to you because it looks at spirituality as well. It takes place on Sunday at 3 o'clock, but is also sadly sold out. But we might repeat it again in the future. We also have a presentation looking at something called medical apartheid. That takes place this Friday, but that is also sold out. But there's two parts to it. There's part one and part two. And part two is not sold out yet. This is a bit further in the future. We're looking at African-American men and women who were cowboys and cowgirls, real people like the woman in the black and white picture, and imagined people like the movie star on the left of the picture. So we're looking at that May the 14th. That was originally scheduled to be at the BFI South Bank. It's a physical event. We took it online because, of course, of the virus. But you can see this information online. It's all on our website, which is blackhistorywalks.co.uk. We also have coming up a course on the amazing James Baldwin. It's a six-week course. We've run it about 5 times now, and each time we run it, it's sold out. It's the first time we'll be doing it online. But the details are all on our website. It's a very interesting course. And then you have this course led by Dr. Michelle Asantua. And it's all about African women who use spiritual resources to fight against imperialism, but also had a particular political outlook. So we're looking at soldiers, politicians, leaders, freedom fighters who use African spiritual systems, as well as either pens or guns to fight for equality. And that's taking place in May 19th is when it starts. And again, the details are online. There's another course looking at Black films and white power. This was supposed to be at the BFI South Bank, but of course, it'll take place there now, it'll take place online. It's all about African films we've been showing for the last 13 years at the BFI South Bank. So we have a massive catalog. We'll be giving people all sorts of detailed information on these African films, how to get them, where to get them from, and why they have such a hard time being produced. And that's also taking place online. So this lecture you're gonna see, or gonna hear today, see and hear today actually, it's part of our Queen Nzingha lecture series. So we've been doing this for about 6 or 7 years or so. And what we do is we actually hire venues and have a black female academic speak in their area of choice. So that's the typical audience we kind of get. And this is one of the, well, it's the second time we've done this online. Your speaker today is Dr. Michelle Asantua. Has a PhD in literature. She specializes in Guyanese comfort. She's a lecturer at London Metropolitan. She's written several books. And she's gonna take you through some African gods and goddesses for about an hour or so, and then have about 15, 20 minutes worth of questions. So without further ado, I'm just gonna stop sharing my screen and hand over to you, Dr. Santula.
Hello, greetings everybody. I'm just wanting you to see me. Hello, and then I'm going to stop my video. Tony, can you see that all right?
Yeah, you just got a black bar at the top.
All right, yeah, that was just a drop down. Okay, greetings everyone. Again, thank you, Tony. Thank you for the introduction and for once again inviting me to present this fabulous introductory session on African gods and goddesses. It's actually the third time we're doing it, twice online, but we did this a couple of years ago physically. It's quite a popular session. And the last time we did it was followed by the one we did a few days ago on zombies and the demonization of African spirituality. So they kind of fit into to each other, but this is just a distinct version. And I just wanted us to bear in mind, this is my honoring of today, which is Earth Day. And this portrait here is of Samuel Lynn's taking of Mother Earth, the goddess, the great mother goddess. It's a beautiful painting that I happen to see in real life. So I very much love it. You can go on, look for Samuel Lynn and check out some of his brilliant works. Okay, the maps here are to show you the idea that this is the this is Africa and these are its countries. Of each of these countries, there are hundreds of different groups of people in one of them alone, say, and each of them will have their versions of what we call God or their ways of honoring the divine or their creation stories. So we just need to bear that in mind as we're looking, that although we're calling it African gods and goddesses, I want you to understand how vast that is in any case, but we're just going to be looking at a very small amount. And so likewise, some of those traditions and the gods and the spirits and the deities were taken with the enslaved Africans to places like here on South America, and also to the Caribbean, and of course the United States. So in all of these locations as well, they will have remnants of those practices that come from the continent, all of them, where there are populous or even a small number of African people, they will have remnants of those traditions. So for example, in Puerto Rico, I'm gonna try and use my pointy thing, Puerto Rico, that's where Samuel Lind is from, who I just showed you that painting of Mother Earth. And that's a small population of Africans where they were sort of dropped off by the enslavers, and the remnants remain there as well. Okay, so it's just an idea for us to understand what is God for Africans traditionally, and bear in mind that we wouldn't have necessarily used that word, but it's just a convenience now. It's no different from other forms of understanding what the Creator does or is, that it's omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient, and so on. That is the supreme power that we understand as God, and that is reflected in all things of nature, both heavenly and on earth. We see God as the provider, the sustainer, who makes things possible, that creative, recreative force. And it's considered that which created itself. So these are some African names for the supreme being. And I said, what I showed you at the outset, those maps, is just to show you that this is like, I don't even know what percentage this would be, but it's a very, very small percentage of the very numerous names that Africans would call their god by. I'm pointing to this one, Zambi, particularly because of the, it links with the presentation we normally do following this, but at the same time, it connects with part of that whole notion of demonization, because it links to voodoo and to zombie and jumbi for some of us who know that. And it's been that those are the negative impressions or the negative forms of this god from the Congo. But otherwise, some of these you might recognize if you're from different, wherever you're from. the Yoruba god Uludamari, Olorun, and so on. There are other, loads of other names for the Yoruba deity as well. It's quite a well-known one, principally because a lot of the enslaved Africans came from Yoruba land and were taken to places like Brazil and so on. So that that kind of identification remains. I'm just trying to see if there is another one. That's Nyame is another one that's kind of well known from Ghana and so on. Okay, so these are some of the forms of the spiritual practices. Very, very few forms that remain extant on the continent and are practiced in the diaspora. So you can see the different voodoos there, voodoo and hoodoo, and voodoo that's still practiced, and voodoo of Haiti as well, still connected in a similar way to the Benin one and so on. The other connections will be Akom, which is the top one, links to, and that's from Ghana, and that links to Kumfa, which is my study, Guyanese Kumfa. And you can see the similarity of the name, and that's really to do with the trance state that the practice entails. In Guyana, it's called catching Kumfa. That means you go into a trance state. And in Ghana, it remains as Akom. Mami Watch is continent-wide, as it says. And then you have the Ifa tradition, which I said comes through to the diaspora quite widely. And it is actually a surgence or a resurgence, if you like, of its practice throughout the diaspora. Santeria being it's probably one of its most well-known. But of course, there are practices throughout the diaspora, as I've said before. Kamina and Mile. Mileism is moderately known. In fact, very little is known of it, but it will be covered actually in the session that I'm doing on Sunday. Mile. Kemetic one, the ancient Egypt, that one is also one of the well-knowns that continues in the diaspora. Okay, if this was like a live session, I would really be asking you, by live I mean if I could physically see you, I would be asking you what this image presents to you, what you can see, what resonates with you when you look at this image. And so some of the things that might come up is this idea of the infinite, something that you can't quite define anyway. So even if I was trying to ask you, you'd still need a time to think about what you're actually seeing. It seems quite vast and unlimited. It's how do you explain what you're seeing? What are those markings, for example? Some of the things that might appear curious to you or to us, even the ones on the forehead, what exactly is going on? It seems unknowable, this impression. That, in other words, is an impression that you might like when you're the idea is when you're trying to consider what God is. And here, from this cosmogony, meaning a creation idea, before the creation of the world, before all things began, there was nothing save one being. This being was a void, without name or limit, yet it was a living void. It harbored within it the sum of all possible existences. It's infinite. Eternal time was the dwelling place of that one being. So this idea of vastness, this idea of unlimitedness, this idea of infinite that was in what was the void before thing began, before consciousness was manifest or made manifest. And this from John Mbiti. There seems to be a force of power or energy permeating the whole universe. God is the source and ultimate controller of this force, but spirits have access to some of it. A few human beings have the knowledge and ability to tap, manipulate, and use this power, this force, such as the medicine men, witches, priests, and rainmakers, some for good, others for the ill of their communities. So this is just giving you an idea of the all-encompassing nature of what we considered God. And this is from the Kemetic tradition here, showing, going back to that whole idea of the void or the vastness, from whence things were then created. And we considered, we basically used the humans, or what would could be considered human form or family, to tell that creation story. And in this case, Nut is a sky god. She's dark, and those are the stars, or deeper than that, actually, throughout her body, giving light. And then Nut would mate, if you like, with Geb, who is below, Geb representing Earth. So most of us are aware of this, as above, so below. So there's Earth, and that's Shu, and Shu is missing his partner, who would be Tefnut, which in another impression, you would see Tefnut, and that's Shu and Air. That's air and moisture. So it's just showing the material, or the matter, the coming into being of the world. And in the fawn of Dahomey, the supreme creator is the goddess Nana Uluku. And just to show you the power of the fact that we had the female as well as the male impressions. And she had a pair of twins, Mawa and Lisa. Basically, they're the sun and the moon. So this is a way we were telling our stories. And when you hear them, you would hear them about the twins or the children, then the twins would have another pair of twins and so on. One of the things that's pertinent to our traditions is this symbol, certainly from Kemet, is the symbol of eternal life for us, which was then sort of transferred or stolen into a cross. But here in this form, it represents the jewel, the top part symbolizing the feminine or female, and the bottom the male. Which is very important to us, going back to what we just saw in terms of the Nut and Geb, sky and earth and so on. And it's just this unity and this harmony of opposites all the time. Here we are with the feminine and the masculine. Every African people recognizes God as one, but having these dual notions as well. Okay, if you put in a search for God in Google, you're likely going to come up with something that looks like this. Or there might be a case where there's no little baby Jesus there. It might just be God, usually white, looking very much like this. At some point after that story wasn't quite washing, they then added Mary to it. So this is God, Jesus, and now Mary. And this is what then became the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Now, I'm always curious about that Holy Ghost. It's like, well, what is that? What does the Holy Ghost look like? Is Mary the Holy Ghost? Or what is the Holy Ghost anyway? Okay, and this is the Trinity as far as Africans know it. It's a man, a woman, and a child. And in this case, it's Osa, Oset, and Heru. Oset, wife of Osa, and their son, Heru, but then taken over to become Joseph, Mary, and Jesus. And by now, I'm trusting that most of you listening will have some familiarity with this. But if you need to go in a little bit deeper than we have time for here, I suggest you look at this video by Professor James Small, talking about the Christianity in ancient Africa, and he mentions this. And for him, actually, whilst others have their symbols, they might have the cross or the Star of David or the Shinto symbols or the yin and yang or whatever the symbol is for their religion, what he considers, or he makes a persuasive argument for, is that the symbol for African traditional practices is a man, a woman, and a child. And in some case, in any case, the mother and child certainly is something that we see over and over. And this is an example of, again, Isis and Horus. That's the Greek name for them, but that's otherwise Oset and Heru. This is what then later happened, just to show you how we then moved into this whole idea of a white Jesus or a white savior, if you like. We have the original 3000 BC Oset and Heru, and then later on we get this version, which is an Ethiopian style version. And then we have what most people have now come to understand as baby Jesus and Mary. But just to say that, you know, you can look these things up and try to get an understanding of how they came into being, but our focus really is to show you the gods of Africa in terms of how the African conceived them and perceived them. But just to show you that the cult of Isis, if you like, how that spread, bear in mind that it's Oset as well. It said here, Isis outside of Egypt. In the Greco-Roman era, the worship of Isis, the incarnation of maternal love, went beyond the borders of Egypt and spread across the Mediterranean basin. A devoted wife with magical powers to bring her husband back to life, and a loving mother who nurtured and protected her son Horus, Isis encapsulated the archetypal womanly virtues. Abroad, Isis became assimilated with other goddesses, such as the Phoenician Astarte and the Greek goddess Athena, Aphrodite, and Demeter. She thus extended her field of influence and became the protector of seamen and navigation and the patroness of trade, and is often therefore linked to Wata Mama or Mami Wata. At the beginning of the first century AD, she had many followers in Rome, particularly women. With the coming of Christianity, there were parallels between Isis and the cult of the Virgin Mary. Well, logically, the parallel, one has to come before the other. And clearly, Isis and Horus came before Mary. Virgin Mary, whose images with the baby Jesus left in the medieval French church, often resembled those of Isis and her son Horus. I put that there because the wording is clearly biased. Okay. So in terms of us understanding the extent of Isis and Horus and the maternal or the mother as very significant and symbolic in African spirituality, this is just another reference that you can look at called The Great Mother. It's on YouTube as well. It's by Dr. Charles Finch. So you can have a look at that as well. I'm not going to read that, but just to say it also gives you an idea of that that journey of how things moved from ancient Africa into what we understand now. Okay, back to Mbiti. According to some cosmologies, there are, besides him, the creator God, other divinities and spiritual beings, some of whom are closely associated with him. These beings are generally the personification of God's activities, natural phenomena, and objects of deified national heroes or spiritual beings created by God as such. And this is where we're going to go and see some of these now. Okay, this was just, I put that in there to just remind me, but Tony's actually done that. But for those of you who are just coming in, we're just mentioning that some of what, or at least a few of what I've mentioned here will be kind of hinted on in this session on Sunday. So that's on Eventbrite and you can book it. I don't want to go into, and this one again, we have like 6 weeks, I think this is a 6 weeks one. And this is a course that we've run a few times, but this will be the first time we will be doing it online and we cover some of what I'm about to talk to in more detail. And of course, this is a Toni Morrison course that I will be running as well. We're running as well, okay? Right, so these are the Orisha from the Yoruba tradition, and you can see this, again, there are some that are quite popular. By popular, I mean in terms of the diaspora, particularly Ogun is one, Shango is another, We haven't got yet. Ocean is here. These are popular ones, but this is just a smidgen of what actually is of the Orishas that there are. But I'm going to just go through some of those popular ones. One that generally isn't considered is Ori, which is where or connects with the word Orisha in any case. And this is really about the head, about consciousness. It's to do with your destiny. It's to do with your character, what you select, because it's Orisha is select head. And it's what you decided you were going to do, what you were predestined to do when you came in. And the Ori kind of navigates you back to trying to connect and to align with that which you came into manifestation to do. Okay. Very, very much an underplayed aspect of the tradition, certainly in the diaspora. Eshu is one that is very, this is also one that's well known. Eshu is a divine messenger, sometimes linked to Jesus in that way. I'm not even going to play on the word Jesus and Eshu, but people do. I'm just listing here some of the things that they some of the aspects. So for example, each of the Orisha will have a particular number, they'll have color, they'll have their different items or their different symbols that you would use to try and call on them. Eshu in particular, if you want to go and do call on another Orisha, you go to him first. Sorry. You go to him first. I'm just going to take a drink of water. And and those are just showing the offerings. Offerings are very important. And each of them have their own offerings. This is here saying that, yeah, he's misaligned with the devil by Christian missionaries. What I didn't say at the top was for Africans, there wasn't really such a thing as devil necessarily. Everything was again about unity of opposites and about balancing and reaching to the ultimate aim of which is to reach your own salvation. Okay, this is a very pertinent Orisha because of what we're going through now in terms of COVID. So it's the Orisha of infections and disease and sickness and so on and health, and it would be to him that right now we would be doing offerings and so on to be healthy, to, you know, to rid the planet, if you like, of, you know, whatever, or your community, or, you know, your family or yourself, of whatever is troubling you. It's quite a deep Orisha and you should look him up. Beside him is Osain. This is another painting by same Samuel Lind that I showed earlier on at the top. And he's the god or the Orisha of forest, herbs and healing. So likewise, you go to him for healing as well, you know, and, you know, like if you have any ailments, it would be to him, you would thank and make offerings and so on, so that he would direct you to what herbs you need to take specifically and so on. And this is Ogun. And Ogun is most basically considered the god of war, but ultimately it's to do with justice. And it's the god of metals. And all these things are like force, like I said, forces of nature, things that, you know, the way we told our creation stories, you know, and the pathways, if you like, for us to attain divinity, aspects of divinity. So we'll be met with certain challenges, and it's how we deal with the challenges, how we war, if you like, with what we are confronted by. I've put this here that says that children of Ogun must not be repressed, because I have a view that some of the youth crimes that we're seeing with some of our African young people, I believe it's a misapplied or misaligned sense of this justice or this need to identify with this power, this presence that is Ogun. It's fiery. It needs to be tempered. I was just doing this here because last time I did this, I was trying to think that this comes across as a god of war, but that's because this is a a game on computer game, PS, PlayStation. I don't know PlayStation, but this is what this character is. You can see the similarities, you can see the colors and everything. And then there's Oya, who is a goddess of wind. Oya is usually paired with Ogun, and as well as Shango, and she's the goddess of the cemetery and the market, which is really to do with rebirth and transformation. That's like as sudden, as swift as what the tornadoes and what winds do. So, for example, if there are any sudden changes happening in your life or whatever, and you want to really understand it, or you want to encourage change to take place, you would go to Mama Oya. And this is, if again you put in God of Thunder, you would get something that looks like this, which is Thor. But then, of course, we have our God of Thunder and Lightning. This is Shango, but it's also to do with virility. And Shango is based on, as I said earlier on, one of the quotations from Viti, that you can deify someone that lived an outstanding and exemplary life, such as this King Shango was. He was a national hero and thus became a deity among the Orisha. This is to show you this very powerful looking child, if you like, of Shango. So he would probably be a Babalawa, meaning a father, Shango, of that deity. And he's donned in that the clothing that reflects that. And this is just a story that's connecting Shango with Oya, because each of the Orisha they're connected with one another, but bearing in mind that they are forces of nature. Again, you know, the things that you need to make lightning work and so on, is that the wind, is that what animates lightning. So here, this is just saying about there's a tale in the New World version of the New World tale of Oya stealing the secret of lightning and thunder from Shango when he was carousing with Oshun, that's another deity, belittles the power of this female warrior. Just as Oya often led Shango in the direction she chose, remember she's wind, tornado, so too she always possessed the power that enabled Shango to direct his bolts of destructive energy at their targets. In this way, the two powerful Orisha worked together, Oya setting the course and Shango delivering the blows. So this is all, again, to show you about what I said at the top, about the unity of opposites, about the duality. And you will always find these in our traditions, this kind of pairing. And this is a female sort of worshipper, if you like, or Shango practitioner. Just want you to take in that beautiful, powerful sister there. Here we have the water. We come to the water deities, which are quite well known. Ymaya or Ymanja or Ymaya. There's just loads of different ways that she's known by, but it's the same Ymaya, a mother of the ocean. And she is one that is particularly relevant for us in the diaspora, because when we were being dragged across the Atlantic, she would have been the one that we would jump off and reunite with, or she would have been the one that we were praying to carry us, you know, to carry us for our survival and so on, and take her in our hearts, and, you know that she's our mother, that she's nurturing us, that she's there for us and so on. And she is paired again with Olukun, Ymaya representing the top part of the the flareful, if you like, the part of the swish of the ocean, the bit that you can see at the top. Olokuna representing or symbolic of the depth, the subconscious region, if you like, for a deeper. That's where the riches are. And I don't mean just simply riches. Yes, there are riches at the bottom of the sea, but riches in terms of when you find that thing, that which connects you to your higher self, you will be an, you will live an abundant sense of your self, and you will find that alignment, because now you're working not just superficially, which is not to say that I'm not using the term superficially, meaning irrelevant, but you're not just dealing with surface level impressions, but you're also working from the depths. And this is Mama Ushun, and she's the river deity, quite well known and well honored. She's probably one of the most renowned. There are lots of continuous practice to her in the diaspora. And she's the mother of sweet waters. She connects with sensuality, creativity, the imagination. She is seductive, she's nurturing, but all of them have these different sides as well. Like, you know, obviously mothers are quite protective, so she's that, so therefore warrior and fierce when that needs to arise. Just to show you that there are other goddesses of beauty which she corresponds with. Hathor is a Kemet one, Kemetian one, Aphrodite, Greek and then Roman, and then there's ocean. And there's loads that obviously that you, by now you should know of other goddesses of beauty, goddesses of love, romance and so on, sexuality. Okay, and then this is another version of same, but now we're in voodoo, we're in Haiti. And this is Azili Fredo Dahomey. Dahomey is actually linked to her name, which is clearly showing you that connection to the continent here. And she is a loa, because in Haitian voodoo, that's what they call their deities, the loa. And she is love, beauty, dancing, and so on. These are just some of the attributes of her. She, in the bottom part, she has that pierced heart. Those of you probably wondering about her, this colouring, but bear in mind that some of the practices merged with what was already there, or what they the enslavers had as well, and where we could find that link to keep it underground or to keep practicing ours, we just merged it with theirs. This is just to again show you, this is a practitioner, that our traditions aren't like static. You do a ritual to call the loa, to call the orisha, to call the comfort energies to come on you as a child of theirs, and you dance for them. And this is what this sister here is doing. And she's wearing, this is a ritual in honor of Azili Fredo Dahomey. And this is another one of the loas, a major loa in the voodoo pantheon. This is the creator god, the serpent god, or the sky god, creator, Dambala. And this is a very powerful god, because it comes, it's just to do with how, you know, to do with creation, to do with rebirth, to do with renewal. The many coils of the serpent, the shedding of its skin. And so we've carried this on actually from the continent, which still continues to be part of the voodoo practice there in Benin. And this is just to show you how transient, if you like, the practice is. So this is in Trinidad, and the picture on the right there is showing this brother who is morphing, if you like, or he's playing mass for carnival, And he's doing so as Dambala. And just to show you the depth to which people would go to maintain these practices. And you might see that, you might land in Trinidad, go to the carnival, see this and think, what on earth is going on? But he knows what's going on. That's to do with he's connecting with the wisdom of the serpent god. He's connecting with its intellect. He's connecting with the higher seat of consciousness, which it entails and so on. Oh, this is just to invite you to go and look at this, or listen to rather, this beautiful tribute to the god Dambala that's done by Nina Simone when you get a chance on YouTube. Okay, since we're in the territory of the serpent god and goddesses, I wanted to bring this part in. And the reason I put this in this presentation is because this sister, Mama Zogbe, Vivian Hunter, has done some research in the Water Mummy or the Mummy Water. And what she's arguing for is that African women have got within them the continuing links to this the primordial mother through our genes genetically, but we are disconnected from this tradition. And so she's trying to make a case for us reconnecting to what we she's calling here the Sibyls, which were diviners, and I'll go through them. The Sibyls were African and were the main oracle of the serpent worshipping tribes. Thus, their prophetic spirit was an ancestral serpent who had issued forth these divine prophecies since the beginning of time. But the church, papal, relating to the Pope, knew this, but had already condemned the serpent spirit as a manifestation of the highest evil, as most of us know. So hence, you consider the serpent to be something of evil. But this is really what she's saying is an ancestral thing. It's an ancestral reference or remnant to the beginning, to the primordial creative force. She's saying here, this is at the back cover of the book, that book there. African women are the only women in the world whose ancient mothers were not born under the yoke of patriarchy. During ancient times, for the first 6,000 years, Africa was ruled by a powerful order of matriarchs. And you'll find more of this if you look at that video by Professor Charles Finch, as I mentioned. Considering the current status of African women around the world today, one could hardly be convinced that her matriarchal presence and the enormous influence she wielded in the ancient world had far exceeded the limited physical, cultural, geographical, and political designations of which Africa and her religions are confined today. During her reign, African religions had reached very high levels of theological and ritual development and were the original spiritual home of the world's first great oracles, prophetess and prophets. Under the rising tide of African patriarchy, the sacerdotal, the sacred order of Sibyls were sold as slaves to build and work the powerful oracles they established in ancient Greece, Rome, Turkey and Babylon. What is now currently the holy seat of the Vatican in Italy was originally the sacerdotal seat of these ancient black Sibyl queen mothers. Centuries before Christ, they were known to heal the sick, restore dignity and strength to the weak, and restore sight to the blind. They were famous for curing lameness, etc., etc. So I came upon this book and I found it quite fascinating, but you're like thinking, well, what's really under all of that? Because the sister has done a lot of research, which I can't verify because I can't go to all these museums that she's gone to. So I'm reading it, but I'm being cautious and I'm kind of mindful of what I'm coming up against, because there's more and more things becoming relevant to us as the years go on, because certain things weren't revealed, but online you can find a lot more. So I'd found this book and I found it quite fascinating. She said here in continuing about what the Sibyls, meaning the oracles and the prophetesses, were doing prior to African patriarchy. They were said to cast out demons and even to raise the dead. Now, bear in mind that what that really means is they would communicate with ancestors. Their prophecies are the oldest and most authentic in the world. They were the basis of Greek and Roman tragedies and plays, which she argues in the book was usurped and taken over as though those were white gods or white women who were doing these. And not to say that those weren't there, but she was saying that the oracles, the Sibyls, they were coming out of the ancient world, which incorporated Africa. More astonishing, their prophetic books were later collected by the Roman authorities, who needed a Western theological foundation in order to compete with the powerful Levitical Jews. These Sibyl prophecies soon became the sole and undisputed precursor to the Western Christian Bible. As the first established sacerdotal African matriarchs, the Sibyls' cultural and religious impact was arguably the most profound on ancient civilization than modern history has ever revealed or cared to admit. And she's just telling us these areas now because she's trying to make us not limit our understanding of where Africa started and where it ended in terms of getting us to think about the wider ancient world. From Mesopotamia to Libya, Mezarim, Kemet, Ionia, Minoa, Turkey, and so on. The Sibyls were the primary divine Vatican and absolute moral authority. The absence of African women's contribution in world history as major economic, political, and spiritual players, as opposed to exceptions to the norm, or mere appendages of great men, has been problematic and disturbing at the best. And so she's trying to challenge this. And this goes on to show that the Sibyls are continued in Budun, which is maintained in Benin and under the Amangazi group. In the West African Budun and current African American as well traditions, an Amangazi is defined as a high priestess whose primary function is divination, namely communication with the dead ancestors, as I mentioned earlier. The African deities and the destiny Uri, as I mentioned earlier, souls of the living. It is an ancient tradition in which the dead, the deities and the souls of the living actually come in direct contact during consultation to speak. The Amangazi tradition is an ancient ancestral matriarchal tradition that is passed down through the generations. Although there are some male Amangazis, 99% of them are women. However, in the West, there are an increasing number of males who are being called to take on the tradition of their ancestors. That's a picture of her there. She's a priestess in the tradition. So I was trying to figure out this this whole idea about the Sibyls and so on. And I was led here to this image online. And again, seeing these oracles, and as Vivian Hunter, Mama Zogbe, was mentioning, how like the Oracle of Delphi would be a subject of the Greek tragedies and so on. But I was curious about these black ones, these African ones. And here is where I found this picture of one that comes up about the Sibyl Agrippina. Of course, there wouldn't have been any images of that. This is just an impression that someone did much later on. And I found this connected to that image there behind. Since the days of classical antiquity, the Sibyls were considered seers sent by God, whose prophecies were, as of early Christian times, taken as indicating the Epiphany. Sibyl Agrippina or Agrippina, the Egyptian, and Sibyl Europea were supplemented in medieval times to bring the number in line with that of the 12 male prophets of the Old Testament, which tallies with some of what Mama Zogbe is trying to say about the usurpation of the Sibyl. Her depiction as a black as black can be associated with the increased availability of black models owing to the rising slave trade in the Netherlands, because the guy who painted it is Dutch. Frequently, they were read against the background of the conversion of African heathens. That's how they were kind of trying to interpret the Sibyls, with the presentation of the attributes of the passion, the flagellum, and the crown of thorns. She alludes to Jesus's suffering. So they're still trying to connect her to Jesus. The banner, which goes back, the banner that you would have seen on, let me go back a minute, there, that scroll thing there, goes back to Filippo Barrier's description of the prophetess of 1481 and so on, can also be interpreted in this light. The painting has lately been attributed to, this is just showing you who they identify that painting from. So again, I was still probing, trying to get some more, and this continues. The name Sibyl is of mixed origins. It is the sacred initiatory title that the ancient Africans called the prophetess, priestesses of the Mamiwata. According to some, it is derived from the black Ethiopian Kushites known as the Phrygians, natives of Mekane. Their name of endearment for Mami was Sibyl, Sibella, Sibyl, Kibyl, Queen other words. Some scholars believe that Sibyl is a Greek corruption of two words, Soi, meaning God, and Bu, meaning to counsel. Both words are derived from the Afro-Elialytic dialect of ancient Mekane. Combined, it reads as Sibyl, which phonetically evolved into the English Sibyl. So this was just me now making that connection from what I saw with Mama Zogbe, and then this is now doing a little bit more online and coming to finding this, which is just random, actually. It's not really evident and obvious online. But then finding someone else must have been following this trail, because they then found these images representing some of the Sibyls online. And then again, they connect with the Amazonians of Dahomey. And this is one that is in Mama Zogbe's book, Penthesilea. And here, this is another version. Yeah, even I think this one actually is online, the one on your left, but notably, I don't know why the nose is chopped off there, but you can look at that hair, and you know, you can make your own interpretation from that. But basically in this book she identifies a lot of these prophetesses from in the museums of around Europe. I think that's it. Thank you very much for listening. I hope you got what you needed to get from that. Thank you.
All right, cool. So we'll take some questions in the chat. So if you have a question, find the chat button or chat area on your screen, and you can type your questions in there. And then Michelle will do her best to answer them. Actually, Michelle, if you can put your slides back up, because people often ask to see them again. So just to see going up and down. All right. So someone was asking about Jay was asking about dollars to pounds. I think she must be American, or he must be American. And they're asking about here we go. This is from April. She says, thank you so much for that. Hold on a second. Thank you so much for that, Michelle. How do people know which Orisha they belong to? So how do people know which Orisha they belong to?
Hey, Tony, can you see that screen at the moment?
Yes, it says African Gods and Goddesses. It's the first screen, the first slide, and you got the wisdom.
How do people know which Orisha they are, they would have? there are different ways, but the main one is that they usually do a consultation by somebody who is a Babalawa or a Ayolo Orisha, which is a female version of that, the priestess in that tradition. who, you know, would divine for them. If they want to know, they would go to that person that has that office, if you like, and they would do a divination, and then it will tell them which is the Orisha that they have on their head, if you like, and that's the one that they will then on off serve or whatever.
Pauline says, thanks for presentation, very informative. And Leila says, thank you so much for this. I found it so informative.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's all that's been said in the chat at the moment. Ubar says, very eye-opening, thank you for your time. And April says, or asks rather, are whole families part of the same Kisha or Orisha? Are whole families part of the same Orisha? Over to you, Michelle.
Is that a question or a statement, Tony? Sorry.
That's a question. It says, are whole families part of the same Orisha?
Whole families?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, that's an interesting one. I think sometimes, yeah, because I know of cases where it's like that, but I wouldn't like to, with the spiritual, it's very difficult and very tempting to say, yes, it's all like this, but spirituality is a lot more, African spirituality is certainly a lot more fluid than that. So, you know, you might say that the family has a family shrine that honors Shango. But that doesn't mean, and bear in mind that all of these energies are, you know, are within us. They're not necessarily something that's real out external to us. They're all energies and pathways that are divine within us for us to realize our own salvation. So yes, and kind of with a caveat that at the same time, you might be selected within that family to be an ocean you know, an ocean follower, if you like. So, but yeah, there are families that have houses to the Orisha.
You got a question from Sylvia. She says, or he says, thank you so much for your presentation. I have noticed that most of your presentation represents male gods as power symbols, while female goddesses are brought about as paired with a male god. Moreover, they are linked to symbology of care, love, and beauty, which is what women in society are, unfortunately, still constrained to. How do you think this representation reinforces patriarchy?
I would challenge the statement that the presentation does that, because actually, and also, is nurturing not something that is valuable, that is a force? If you actually look at, I mentioned ocean and I was talking about that caring and I was talking about all that nurturing, because that is a power in itself. But ocean was one of the, there's stories around ocean being taken for granted by the other Orisha, particularly the male ones, and the supreme being had to go and remind them, due to what ocean was capable of doing, that they cannot do anything without her. And Oya is a warrior goddess. You know, it's just the representation of what that power is might not come across as virile, but you must bear in mind that this is the way ancients interpreted for the sake of what is a masculine as energy. It's not, it's the pairing of opposites. So it's how they complement each other, not how they are in warring oppositions to each other. And I think that is something that is an inheritance of Western interpretations, but it's certainly not ours.
Okay, Adeline says life changing, and Nike says very informative, thank you. Then it's another question from Sonia. Says, greetings, is there a book you would recommend as an introduction to developing a knowledge and understanding of gods and goddesses? So a book you'd recommend, Michelle?
Yeah, there are there are different books for the different traditions, but I would look at Patrick, Nearmark, The Way of the Orishas. That is a good one to start with. Hold on a minute.
Okay, and while you're looking, there's a question. There's a question from Ray. He says, there is much stuff online on Kemet in Egypt, gods in West Africa and Yoruba gods. It seems hard to find anything on Congolese ancient gods. Do you have anywhere for an amateur to start looking or researching Congolese ancient gods?
Yeah, I must say that is based on what came out or what comes out of those traditions. Because I know people tend to go, oh well, where's our thing? But it's what is out, is what comes out of those traditions. So for example, Ghana, that order is tends to be very private. So you don't get much that's coming out. But you can look at the Mabuti, the John Mabuti book, African Religions, to get an idea. And as a place to start, because remember those books are gonna have a bibliography at the back, and you can have a look there. But they are there, it's just that those are deeper in, they're not as obvious. And so it's not that us as presenters don't want to include them in our work. So for example, the practice that I'm familiar with that's in my book, Kamfa, it has remnants of Congo, hence the Zambi or the god Zambi. That's what we know. But in terms of books that deal with it, you know, it's patches here and there. I just wanted to go back to the question about the Orisha or the other god. This is Philip Neimark, Way of the Orisha. That's quite a sort of a basic one, if you like, that will give you the attributes of the Orisha and so on. There is Joseph Yohanan's African Origin of the Major Western Religions. I can't see where I can type it in, though. That's the only thing here.
I'll do it for you. In the meantime, this is from Okusua. Very interesting and fascinating. Thank you so much. Where can I find out more about Akan gods and how the spiritual systems are connected? From Jay, for the diaspora, do you think we should look to religions on the continent or attempt to salvage the Africanity of our own syncretic religions?
First question again goes back to what I was saying just before, because that's Ghana as well. And I know of Ghanaian practitioners who are very secretive about some of their traditions. So it's very difficult to find texts, books that are talking about those traditions. Those are a lot of them are oral histories. And again, we in the diaspora, in terms of Kamfa, which is my country's, one of the practices from my country, we know of the connection to Akom and so on, but I'm not too aware of a book that will have that all-encompassing Akan cosmology. It doesn't seem to be in these slides, but Ancestral Voices, yeah. I suggest you look at their website, which is ancestralvoices.co.uk, because there are some things there on ancestors. And there is a book, I don't remember the writer, but it's called On Ancestors, and that is from Ghana. So there are little patches of things like that. And certainly some of the practitioners of Akan were speaking with the Ancestral Voices team.
All right, so Michelle, you got Kashka saying, thanks. This is my second time and I cannot get enough. She says, thank you very much, great work. And then from Dee, he says, not a question, just a story. I was once a part of a divination group where we worshipped and gave libations to goddesses that were mainly Celtic and Greek. And there's another one here that says, the same person saying, My meditation made me have contact with an African goddess instead. Interesting experience. Sorry, my story cut off, so I think I chat got cut off. Vanessa says, brought up as a Christian, but with growing knowledge, have shunned that religion. What might you suggest as an effective first step towards African spiritual practices?
Okay. There was a question I know before that I feel like I didn't answer, but anyway, I'm going to try and answer this one. I'll maybe come back to that. Thanks for the sharing of the story for the previous one as well. My first suggestion and my go-to when we're doing these things, because of the nature of this presentation, it's like African gods and goddesses. But the reason why I was going on about Mama Zogbe and her work is because ultimately she's trying to get us to think about ourselves from an ancestral perspective of our ancestors. And my way in to my understanding of African spirituality was through the ancestors, through my understanding of my direct line ancestors, my mother's mother and her mother and so on. That's your way in. Because, you know, they are who you know. They are the nearest and the closest things to you. So you need to have an understanding of your ancestors. You can't bypass your ancestors and say you're going to be honoring one of the Kemetic deities or one of the Orisha or whatever. It doesn't actually make sense for you. And you know, sometimes that's to do with that's this feeling of, well, I don't know who my ancestors were. Well, you must know because you have them. Even if you say, I don't know your name, but who are you? And, you know, guide me. And it starts to open up because this is to do with consciousness ultimately.
And also don't forget that, you know, when you do the course, Michelle, we do cover that stuff in a bit more detail, or a lot more detail, actually. Norma says, thank you, very interesting. I have lots of research to do now with a smiley face. Patricia says, many thanks, Michelle. Your knowledge is valuable and it's a good start for me to continue researching our history. Toysin says, thank you for your presentation. When you mentioned the void, Mandy, I'm reminded of the Gnosticism, Yahweh. Is the void in that theology and is actually a miscarriage of Sophia? Is there anything you've come across in your studies that mentions this?
No, I couldn't make that.
Okay. Natasha says, great presentation. I'm from Zimbabwe and we have our gods as well. But I understand as Bantu people, we are connected and want to expand my knowledge of my other African gods. My mother is Zulu. My father is from Mozambique, very spiritual people. Great to have more knowledge. Thank you. She put up two hands together as an appearing. Thank you, icon. Similar question from Charlotte. I'd like to learn more about East African gods, goddesses and mythology.
Yeah, yeah, there's only so much that my research took me to. So I think the direct response to that, if that was a question, is to speak to your elders.
Okay, cool. Andrew says, thank you very much for this presentation. I've heard that many raised in the Christian traditions in the West are turned away and returned to traditional African spiritual practice. What are your thoughts on this? And then Umar says, is there a parallel link between astrology and God's goddesses' energy?
yeah, in terms of returning or doing, yeah, this is kind of a natural. If you're trying to seek truth, if you're a truth seeker, somewhere along the line, something with the practices that were forced on you, something is going to kick in and you're going to go, this doesn't sit right with me. That's if you're genuinely trying to figure out yourself, because you're trying to work your way back to some primordial source, the void, if you like. And Christianity and some of the other traditions don't allow you to do that, to ask those questions and to get you there. And what does is some of these traditions, whichever one you take, is ultimately about answering the question of who am I? What's my connection to the divine, to God? You know, how do I become divine and so on? So yes, that's why. What's the other one, Tony?
Is there a parallel link between astrology and God's goddess's energy?
Yes, I mean, certainly it's in all of them, because all of them it's to do with the ideas of creation and those attributes of creation. We were telling stories to ourselves so that we could understand how we came into being. And so, yeah, there are certainly some people, I mean, you know, I haven't got it imprinted on my brain, so, but I know they do things like, say, for example, Shango might be linked to, Shango, I think, is linked to Jupiter and so on. Some of the Orisha, like Ogun, is linked to Mars, and so on. And then you have the Kemetic traditions, which likewise I've showed you earlier about the Nut and the sky and so on. So yeah, very, very much so.
Okay, Bolanle says this statement with question at the end. I'm first generation Nigerian British, father from Abeokuta Primary in GB. Went to primary school in GB, in England, I think is what it means. And not exposed to my history until the age of 11. Attended university in Ife, so your lecture has been fascinating. My Muslim grandmother was Muslim, but always said the traditionalists were there before Christianity or Islam. So respect those that worship the traditional gods. Fascinating. Someone has asked my question, further reading for West African religions, are African religions, the way of the Orishas, I think that's a book reference there.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. The way of the Orishas is the one with Philip Neymark, N-E-I-M-A-R-K.
Okay. Mariah says, thank you for this offering. Can you explain Ori again? I thought this only referred to one's fate, but is this also an Orisha?
Yeah, so Ori acts as an Orisha as well, because that's like your first, if you like, that's your first Orisha, because that's your consciousness, that's your head. Yeah, Ori is head. The Orisha are select head, so the one that is your predominant one, like you might be an Oshun, you know. But Ori is that which guides and directs your destiny, and there are different aspects of your Ori, you know, like to do with your character, and you know, to have good character and so on, that what you came in with, because sometimes you can't change your character, but you can change your destinies by particular service, by offering, by being faithful, if you like, to the Orisha, and being true to your Ori, being focused in that way.
And I think we have a bookshop owner in the chat room. I think that's Emmanuel, actually. He says he has some of the books you've been mentioning. He can be reached on, in fact, if you're in the chat, you can see the number. So this is from Ida, E-D-A-M-E-V-O-R at u.uk, and he's given his phone number and email, and he has some of the books that have been mentioned so far. Lani asks, does the British Library hold a decent collection of books in the subject, please? Fascinating lecture.
Yeah, they will have them, but at the same time, I know that some are in the annals of the continent where we can't get to, and we give thanks to those people, like I mentioned, Professor James Small and a host of them, who do get to go to the museums, and who get to go, you know, to Kemet, who get to go like to Haiti and Cuba and all of that, and they bring back this knowledge to us that you can't find in the museum. You can't find in the British Library necessarily, and they have them on YouTube. So if you do a search and on YouTube for the Kemet stuff, or some of the Orisha, you know, there's a lot more Kemet stuff, I must admit, but Professor James Small certainly does a sweeping look at them. And the Ancestral Voices DVD, you must get that as well, because that they are a British couple that went and looked at the traditions across the diaspora and on the continent, and they put that in DVDs. There are two DVDs called Ancestral Voices. The second one is Ancestral Voices, Spirit is Eternal. So you can look for that on ancestralvoices.co.uk.
Vanessa says, thanks so much, Michelle. I've started on the journey of connected to my African ancestors. Great presentation. April asks, why do you think that although much of our spirituality is still very much alive, a lot of it is on the margins or underground and not even accepted by our own African people at times? due to the internalization of racism. I think she answered the wrong question there. do you believe that our African spirituality is a major part of our true freedom? And if so, have you seen a trend in more of our people going back to seek this? If so, if not, what do you think this means?
Okay, great. Because I do remember there was somebody that asked a similar question where they were talking about whether we return to the continent version or whether we sort of carve a path out for ourselves in the diaspora in terms of Africanicity. And personally, I think if you're dealing with your culture, and your culture is what defines you in terms of your identity, your mores, your values, your everything. And Africans are just, you know, very, very spiritual. It's like, it's impossible to go anywhere on the continent without even, yes, they have the ones that have been, superimposed onto them, the Christianity and Islam, but predominantly, but still, when certain things can't be done via those means, via the white Christian God, they're finding that traditional healer, you know, or the Babalawa or the whatever. And this is the same in the diaspora. There is a natural continuity. I didn't mention my own book, actually. I mean, Tony might have mentioned it at the top, but this is something I look at in my book, Guyanese Comfort, and in terms of thinking about how we do naturally have that connection, but it's just usually summoned by some dream or some accident or some dire necessity, and then we're forced into looking back at our who we are and where we're coming from. But certainly what the question was is this a way for our liberation? Well, we need to go to Haiti and see how the Haitians fought for their liberation. That's one example. But in terms of our own, certainly, I think that if we're going to really be serious about what it means to have a cultural compass and center, you definitely need to incorporate your spiritual your spirituality. What is your spirit? What hasn't been broken, and it's there.
This is from Francesca. She says, thanks for the informative lecture. I'm working on a project that explores beliefs and practices of spirituality in African communities. One thing that continues to come up as a topic amongst some of my older family members is to use the term witchcraft to prevent, cause, or remedy harm. So, for instance, I've heard from many of my family members link physical illnesses to spiritual harm that someone else is trying to do to them, and thus will seek advice from healers before medical doctors. While that family member's continued good fortune is due to a spiritual protection given by their grandmother, for instance. Are there particular gods or goddesses that I can do additional research on to learn more about the roots of these spiritual beliefs or practices?
It's kind of a convoluted thing because you're talking on the one hand about the witchcraft, and then you're talking about any external particular gods and goddesses that are related. I didn't really understand what the question necessarily was, Tony.
I think the final part of the question was, where can she get more information on spiritual beliefs and practices to do with demonized African religions? I think that sums it up.
I mean, this is where the demonized versions. This is where I don't exactly know where she could find the information other than the work I've done and the work we did the other day.
Our previous lecture.
The previous lecture is what I'm talking about, the demonization of spirituality. But in any of the books that are trying to look at it, they will mention that bit about the fact that there are certain things that we couldn't do. And, you know, there is a book called Enacting, it's about Obia. I'm trying to remember the name of it now, where they created laws against our practices but there's nothing that I specifically know of that will look at, just focus on that, other right. than coming out of white European ideas.
Fair enough. Actually, maybe Marimba Annie's books. She has some big fat books on the whole topic of, you know, brainwashing and decolonization of the mind, etc.
Getting at where they're getting at. I'm just trying to remember the name of the book by.
Remember, Ami's book is called Yurugu, which is why you are GU, isn't it? Why you are GU, I think it is. Yurugu by
Yurugu. I mean, I touch on some of it in my book, but it's not like a big long thing. And we know certainly like that. Ajays are the power of the witches, if you like, in Yoruba. So there are positives and there are negatives, and there are ways that some of the tradition, just like we have with the major religions that you're aware of, there are negative aspects to that, meaning that people misappropriate them. And I touch on that in the lecture that I'm going to be doing actually on Sunday.
Susan says, Susan asks, do you have a simple method, ritual or prayer for connecting with one's ancestors, please? And there's another question similar from, I think it's from Carolyn. Where's it gone? Carolyn was asking about... Yeah. Sorry. Carolyn says, do you know of any communities in the UK who gather to discuss ATRs, share knowledge, or support each other on this journey?
Yeah. The first one is that you can simply, I don't know if you have an altar in your house, in your room or wherever, but that's one of the first ways you can start by connecting with your ancestors. I do normally do a workshop on that, and one was scheduled, but it had to be cancelled. But I will try and do one actually online of a sort to show you that you can have an altar and you can put some water, you can get a picture of the ancestors that you know that have passed, put that on the altar and with a candle, and then you just go there, and it's like a focal point where you would go and you would commune with them. You could put some, and then you can add things incrementally as that guidance encourages you to do. What was the next one? What was the other question, Tony?
I forgot myself, actually.
I can't remember what the other question was.
Sorry. There was the question was from Carolyn. Do you know of any communities in the UK who have to discuss?
Yeah. Well, there are pockets of them, but I know that some others organize rituals in the summer in August to go to the river. We've been doing that now for a few years. So yeah, there's that, but I don't know. There are pockets of them, but I don't know what names necessarily they come under to that meet regularly to discuss. Mm. However, the Pan-African Society Community Forum sometimes has those sessions.
Oh, they do, yeah, of course. And then there's... Yeah. They have something called Shamira with
Al-Kabulan.
Yeah, they're the one in Sanders up in Tottenham, I think it is.
Yeah, and my art centre sometimes has things as well.
Yeah.
But those are more like people put on something, the my art ones, they put on these events around the discussions and the topic. So you can drop us a line, however, where you do that, so that we can send you the links to those.
Yeah. Pauline's asking, can we see the last slide? The last slide, please, before you guys go. She's looking for the social media and the emails for your organization, Michelle. Okay. And yes, ATR stands for African Traditional Religions. Vanessa, you're asking that. Junior B says, an altar workshop would be great! Exclamation mark.
Say that again.
Junior B says an altar worship will be great, exclamation mark. Marcy says, thank you for sharing your knowledge. And are there still, this is from Ray, Ray Luke says, are there still any Pan-African schools or meetings for children? I know the pandemic has closed everything, but I was looking for my son for a long time before. Well, I know that Al-Kabulan runs a really good Pan-African Saturday school in Leytonstone, which is in East London, so I know that'll help you. But there, you just look for Al-Kabulan, which is A-L-K-B-U-L-A-N. And they have a weekly radio show, and they have a Facebook page, and you know, they have a whole bunch of stuff going on. But they definitely have a really good Saturday school in East London, if that helps at all.
Tony, can you see that slide? That's the last one.
Let me just check. Hold on a second. Because we're actually running out of time now. Oh, yeah. Thank you for listening. Way with words, email, etc.
Tony, I was just going to mention as well, NABS, if they, because he will have a list of the Saturday schools.
Yeah. The NABS is the, let me write it down for you. I'll put it in the chat. It's nabss.org.uk. That's the, oh, is it? Well.
National Association of Black Supplementary Schools.
Yeah. There's two S's actually. NABSS.
Yeah.
Other than that, check out our website and make sure you're on the mailing list, because we do this sort of thing all the time, all year long. We have at least 13 more events like this in the next couple of months or so. So make sure you kind of follow us and get on our social media. Join the mail list and check out the stuff that's coming up. But we have to finish for now. So I have to say thank you very much for coming out. Well, not coming out, but coming out at all. Thank you for attending. I will see you in the future, hopefully.
Thank you very much. Have a wonderful day. Happy Earth Day. Enjoy your evening.